So yesterday I stopped with promising some topology and I introduced before the physical stability in rather general terms of skirmions. And now if he finally decides that he knows me, I will show you something on topology. And I will do this at an extremely introductory level, so I will introduce the notion of homotopy for the very simplest case, namely the XY magnets, and just this pictorial representation, so that you get an idea why people are so excited about using this. So essentially what one uses in topology is upper geometry, so one doesn't cut, one can deform at any random place, and one hopes that finally one understands something about global structures without measuring anything. So, and this is the text, the issue which I will first cover, and then I will do a bit more fancy things about this systems where you can hope to find multidimensional solitons, skirmions, and so on, specifically naturally then for this non-central symmetric numbers. So what I'm concerned with, this is definitely talking things about the exceptional nature of skirmions, namely that they are multidimensional. I explained yesterday, I explained why this is a special thing that you have static solutions of that kind. Just such a block of fibers in somewhere completely smooth. Now I will explain what is about topology. The connection between the stability and topology is not so clear. There may be something in a very global view about, let's say, differential geometry, the real geometry of this thing, and the ability to have a topological index in this. It is clear if you have such a reverse spin configuration here that you cannot get rid of it in a two-dimensional magnet. But this is a bit too complicated to visualize, so I will start with a topology of textures in this type of structure. So I have an XY magnet where the scatter vector or the magnetization in a ferromagnet rotates just in a plane and twists here. And you see then going along this in one dimension, you twist by 2 pi. So you do the circle once. The idea of homotopy, how to measure them, that something like this and just count, is the following, that you go in loops after loops and look how many you cover in the other parameter space. So the idea is the model of a one-dimensional XY magnet that you just have the angle which encodes in which direction your scatter vector or your vector order parameter points. This order parameter manifold is just the sphere of one, the circle. And texture which you want to describe in this would be then that you map from the real space one-dimensional in our simple model onto this S1, which is the order parameter manifold. But this is not nice because we have the infinity, so we close this space, the real space on which our magnetic texture lives by using stereographic projection and compactify, as it is called in this jargon of the mathematicians, into sphere one also, just as so again. You see that you can all describe all the different magnetic textures by mapping S1 to the S1 and looking how many times, as I said, one rotates here around all the parameter space if one goes from infinity minus here, which is the same point as infinity plus, once around here the real space, using the stereographic projection. So the Viking number is then very easy to understand, and this is here depicted like this. You wrap the other parameter space, you wrap the real space, so your pre-image space around the other parameter space. This is the other parameter space, and the nearest point along the radial direction encodes for this space, spatial location in the ring space, in which direction the other parameter was. And so this texture here, when going around now like this, would say, okay, I just do a 2π circle. And this would be winding number, if you count in a certain direction, w equal minus 1. This here would be in our rubber geometry, a texture which is trivial. It looks very complicated, but it means that you go in the direction once the full circle, and then you stop, and then it will take back. So you can contract this clean loop here to a single point and see that it is really trivial. This is just the identity of such possible maps. And you can then see that you can do something like this. You cut here open and add another circle and go around again. And this is encoded here. You go twice around here. And this would be then the winding number minus 2. By this you see already that I have a group structure. I have something like addition. And I have the identity. And I can also go back. I can, for instance, go in this direction in the other way around. So I have a group structure, and that's, therefore such a group is called a homotopy group. This is a pi 1 of S1. This is the first or fundamental homotopy group of the sphere. And to know then this group and what structure this has, once we have decided how you do such homotopy, just the nets, and look how you can deform them, and count how many times you wrap, in that case, is a loop around another parameter space, says then what sort of topological index you have. Here it is relatively trivial. You see that these are just the natural numbers. So the P1, the first homotopy group of the sphere, one is the natural numbers set. We can use also homotopy ideas to detect defects in your texture, and this is also avoiding your magnetic textures. So in that case, you assume, for instance, that you have a vortex defect here. Again, we have planar spins in the x-y direction, now projected in the x-y plane, and here in the center you have a vortex, which is a defect where you cannot define what the order parameter should be. So I've cut out this. If we have a continuum model, this means that this part of the thing you cannot describe in the continuum theory as a constant vector, classical vector, these two components. And you have to do some, add some microscopic theory here at the center to understand real physics which would apply for such a defect. Now I encircle this again with a loop and look how along the loop this other parameter will rotate. And again, as you see that once you go around the loop, you see that the spins also rotate just once. So if this was trivial, you would see that there would be no binding of the other parameter around such a loop. And by this trick, you can then see that you have here in the center of such an object, this was our previous figure. You have just a charge one vortex. This means that the other parameter around this point in the plane winds just once. All these other configurations can be reached by continuous deformation, so they are all charge one vortices. And you see, this is not a geometry which measures, but this is a geometry which just looks at global features, which are countable. And this here would be the anti-vortex, so you can combine these two things in the plane and then globally insert in this whole thing. And it's a nice exercise if you have some time. You see that this is trivial again, that these two charges of the defect disappear. So this was the simplest but also fundamental thing in mathematics. Then when you look into textbooks or such homotopy theory, everything starts with a fundamental group. Once you know along loops how continuously something evolves, you can construct higher homotopy groups and you can understand, so to say, the global topology of objects, which eventually allows you then to analyze such situations that you map from spheres to spheres. which is one of the classic things where homotopy theory is used in physics and was developed by mathematics a long time ago. So, now we do a bit more complicated things. We are looking now at the Heisenberg-like magnets where you have three component vectors, and as I said, the other parameter manifold is just the sphere, so the three component vector is oriented, a unit vector to encode here is S2, the sphere, the classic is the sphere in our three-dimensional space, and I can look at the first homotopy group of such a sphere. And again, this is very trivial. I can then look that I have a loop on this sphere. This would be my space which I want to see how the other parameter evolved along it. But such a loop in our rubber geometry, I can just contract that really disappears in a point. This means this is always trivial. We have always an extra order parameter, the new dimension by which you can avoid to have any defect or any non-trivial configuration. This means there are no line defects in Heisenberg-like magnets. And then I can do the same thing by using a map between S2 to S2. And this is then the skirmion number which interests you, that you have a skirmion somewhere like this in a plane, and you map the plane, again compactified to S2, to the other parameter space. Then the skirmion looks like this, that you project from infinity, which is here the spin up. This would be this point here, at this point. From infinity, you have a plane underneath this object here, you project the spin direction to this point, the north pole, and you have the south pole here, the spin down, and in between you have a radially, which is projected by stereographic projection along this line, these are the cat marks. You see that the spins point just always perpendicular to this object. This means you wrap the sphere once around the sphere, and such a skirmion has skirmion number 1. Plus or minus 1 depending on the convention which you choose about orienting these spheres here. The nice thing is that you can calculate the skirmion number density from a local density, and this is this expression here. So in your plane you integrate just two-dimensionally. This is a totally undiscriminating tensor, such an expression, and this expression here would be the skirmion number density, and it is one of the miracles then that if you integrate this object here, whatever its deformation it is, there will be an integer number residing here for Q. So this looks completely smooth and innocent and good. Look as if you get any real number, but in reality any such object delivers only a Q equal to an integer. This is a Pontryagin index for such an object, and the second homotopy group which encodes all this and can be calculated, the indices by this description here are again the natural numbers. This is actually for all the mappings of spheres to spheres, if really the index of the field space loop which we are using, or plane, or whatever the other parameter is, if these indices are equal, then we get set. Natural numbers. This means also we can put many skirmions of that kind next to each other, and the total charge, topological charge of this thing will be just the number of skirmions which we have in this game. So this is a fascinating thing about this topology, that this is stable in this sense, and that we can be sure that as long as we do not lose something drastic to the material, to this texture, it will stay like this. Even if we deform it, we can elliptically deform it, that it looks, for instance, here elongated in one direction, and it looks like a piece of two piping, a piece of helix, still globally will be skirmion with charge number 1, And we can also move this, say, from a region where you have out-of-plane magnetization into a region where it is in-plane magnetization, and it should deform somehow, but as long as it deforms only smoothly, the Sturm-Leon number of this configuration which results will be still one. So, this is just to remind you that there's, in that case, a prescription that we can define Sturm-Leon numbers as local densities, which means also that if you have your base space, a nanostructure which has rims or edges or something, you can still define local Sturm-Leon density or number density. So quantify essentially the solid angle which is covered by your spin texture locally. But it doesn't mean that such objects like, say, a vortex in an anode disk also have really a topological stability, because all these objects can just sweep across and push out of your specimen, and then it is gone. Here we have, so to say, protected our Sturm-Leon number density and this integer quality of the Sturm-Leons by having this closed sphere as a physical space. In German, it is much nicer that you do not speak about pre-image and image, but pre-build and build. And you have always to look also what is your physical space on which your texture lives, to say something is topologically really stable in a mathematical sense, and something has only some such Sturm-Leon number. Look at the Sturm-Leon number density in reality. Now we can then look, and this is naturally something new as magnetism. People should know very well what is the corresponding effect in this second homotopy group of the classical sphere. This is also set. And this is clear. If you look at this and read this now as our defecting detector around the point, we have a closed sphere, and then wonder what is the defect inside. It's a block point, a hedgehog, a monopole. There are many names of this, but I mean, the magnetism community can be rather proud of this, that the Feldkeller already, and some others already very early, long before my topology reached physics, knew about this and described all these effects, and also said this can arise in magnetism. So this was just in free magnetism we wanted to understand, and saying that it is not always possible to have a thin film of some shape with some domain structure in it, and that everywhere the unit vector of micromagnetism, just the magnetization direction, is well defined. There may be somewhere a point which is singular. That's the Funken magnetism community, because it sometimes also felt similarity. So you have monopoles, and we need them to have Sturm-Leons, because it's clear if you want to introduce a Sturm-Leon in a thin film, and this would be such a conformation of a thin film. You have to, or you want to get rid of it, and this has a certain thickness, like I described yesterday, and you want to have this localized here and destroy it, then one way to do it is just to cut it, and you have to put a, so to say, a hedgehog here on top, and like a zipper, run it through to the bottom of this film, and then the Sturm-Leon is disappeared. Disappears. This means you have just this sort of simple algebra where you have to look in your configuration if it is list defects, that how many Sturm-Leons are there, how many singularities, block points, hedgehogs you have, and then you can, so to say, transform the whole thing globally until you reach a trivial state, or you can do the reverse thing, where the homogeneously magnetized film and a block point runs from bottom to top or the other way around, then you get a Sturm-Leon. This is what really has to happen in a material, and as I said, these block points require microscopic considerations, which for almost, one can say for classical magnetic materials, we do not know exactly what to do. In principle, at the moment, one could do something like the large scale VFD calculations and really look microscopically what is the spin configuration and the energy inside it. For chiral magnets and Solzhenitsyn-Moria interactions, it is even harder because there are some, this anti-symmetric exchange says something about how this block point looks. If you have only exchange on these block points which I showed here, something like this, but you can also rotate something, rotate these things around any arbitrary axis would have the same energy. But the real material will be different. And the energetics of probe points is something which we do not know much. There are a few observations in literature, in static configurations, but otherwise we do not know enough at the moment about this. So, this is, so to say, the thing which you should probably, as a starting point, know about this in magnetism. And I could quickly collect here the relevant homotopy curves which for magnetism. This was a case that vortices in an X-ray magnet belong to this first homotopy curve of the S1 of the simple circle, and this is set. And I told you that if here are the same indices, these homotopy curves of spheres have always this simple integer, are simply the group of integers under addition. And you can add and subtract from each other, and the number of topological charges in such a situation. This here is important that there are no line defects in Heisenberg-like magnets. This is different, for instance, in the matrix, where the up and down direction of the odd light molecule encode the same and is not a vector. So in that case, we know there are never any lines which are singular in a Heisenberg-like magnet, in our classical magnets, or also in an antiferro magnet. This one is a crucially important skirmion number, which stabilizes topologically the skirmions I'm discussing. And there's a counterpoint, the defect for this, which is necessary to create skirmions. This year, I discussed also just yesterday that the non-collinear magnets, if we think about the 120 degree wave structure, belong, have an order parameter manifold, which is a group of rigid body rotations. And the first homotopy group of this has a structure of grid, so set 2, 0, or 1. And there's a possibility to have a planar, in a planar system, a texture which has vortices. The vortex, in that case, is its own antiparticle, if you think of this as a particle, so it dispels itself to vortices. Such structures have been seen and described over the last many years in non-collinear antiferro magnets, and one knows that they can exist, and they will also exist in parallel antiferro magnets eventually. Now, this here is something which we are still waiting to see in magnetism. This is a real texture. And this I should briefly explain. This is a Hopf vibration, so you map the three-dimensional sphere which lives in four dimensions, but is a compactified version of our Euclidean space onto a three-dimensional vector and our usual order parameter manifold of Heisenberg magnet. And this Hopf vibration and the topological index corresponding to this says something about how pre-images or builder of loops are linking together. So this is a completely non-local topological index, and you cannot calculate it from local density. In principle, it should exist in magnetism, but it has not been let seen. So someone of you should do it, I think. Because in antiferro magnets, it may be possible to create something, and it may have very strange properties. So this is a short introduction into some ideas, topological ideas, which are necessary to analyze textures. And I stop this with a few statements about this. As I said yesterday already, topology is for physics a weak state, a weak concept, because it doesn't measure. It says only something about global structure, but it's very attractive because it allows us to describe situations where in the continuum, for instance, particles arise. And this was an attraction of Skirmion model, because in the Skirmion model you could describe nucleons, as I also described yesterday, as arising from knots in a continuum field. And so you have counter particles described just by topology. And this is something which in field theory is actually extremely attractive. Extended particles are described and arise in the continuum. It says nothing about stability and geometry. This double geometry you should take very seriously, because if someone tells you that some object has this or that topological index, you do not know how it looks and what you are looking for. So if you can only calculate or make a statement about the possible topological index of some texture, it doesn't help you too much. The strength of the topological classification is mainly that we can really say the resulting configurations are different. And this means, for instance, if you run a hysteresis loop with some external bias, like in magnetism is a standard thing, and you see discrete jumps, then you should analyze whether really the topology can change, whether something topologically changes a lot. If this is the case, we know for sure that it must be a first order like jump-like process with some discontinuity, and there the effects come into play. Okay, so this is topology. Now I go back to more physics-based reasoning about skirmions, and I tell you something about skirmions in magnets. Originally, it was introduced as topologically non-trivial solutions in magnetism for Heisenberg magnets by Benjamin Polyakov and co-workers. These are the Benjamin Polyakov solutions, and they showed clearly that for this Heisenberg-like magnet, you recognize here only the exchange energy. You can have any charge type of solid body configurations which have this Gomeo number. But these things are not topologically stable. You can really use what Popovic calls meromorphic functions to encode this and enumerate all of them, and the different conformations can be really parameterized analytically. But all these solutions are indifferent with respect to state scaling. This was the argument I addressed with the Hopper theorem, that something like this is not physically stable. So there are scale-independent finite energy solutions. If you add the anisotropy, so a potential term, they immediately collapse. But this means that these configurations as a starting point to do calculations or to analyze situations really exist. And one can then look for sort of different types of solutions are really possible. Because the topological index, which says you have that many skirmions inside this thing, doesn't tell you whether they are sitting in one lump, whether they are somehow interacting or remote from each other, and how exactly the demagnetization distribution is there. And because the exchange is this larger scale, this Benjamin Polyakov solitons give you an idea what is possible. Now, stabilization mechanisms can be used in various ways, and there have been a lot of possibilities, and almost all of them rely to a classic skirmion type of models. So you add higher order gradients. In that case, you see there's a higher order gradient like this, and this was the first suggestion. I know very explicitly for magnetic fields, it was simply assumed that something like this. Now, this additional energy term with higher gradients means that you introduce extra length scale. And I will quickly later show this. Here's another example which is extremely attractive to show, but it has, you see a sixth order term in an magnetization and fourth order in gradient, so it is extremely difficult, but it is known that in magnetism this sort of electron model makes extremely complicated knots, and it could be applied eventually for certain antiferromagnets, and is also candidate for realizing something like fourth textures. This comes from PDA. Now, closer to magnetism in your sense, and which could be used, is a very simple exchange frustrated and again XY magnet. So you have a J1 and J2 with different sign here. I encode the curl angle in the XY magnet here as a theta, and you have the first neighbor and second neighbor interactions. And you can transform this, and this was done in the first book by Alex Huppert and Romain Walz in a very short paragraph in the 1970s, that you can transform this into such a form that you recognize that you have here the second order cutting down and you have fourth order cutting terms. And the pattern analysis is also for Heisenberg like magnets. So this is the field theory, which says you will have again the possibility to do not only one-dimensional, but multi-dimensional modulated states. Essentially, such a function can be used, for instance, for a one-dimensional magnet, which is a Hilbert magnet, if this becomes complete, to describe, as we did a long time ago with this model in the field theory language, the transition from a Hilbert magnet to the transverse field to a so-called fan magnet. There's nothing spiral in this model, and it describes just systems like the manganese 2-volt, manganese gold 2, which is a classic Hilbert magnet where you have manganese layers on top of each other, which are ferromagnetically coupled and keep the helix in the same direction in the tetrahedral system. In recent years, and I advertised in this paper by Leonov and Mostovoy, in recent years, lattice-based models of this have been investigated, and it is shown really that these systems have localized sodium-like structures, which are different from the chirosomal fermions I have described so far. For one thing, is because the scale, which is introduced by this J1 and J2 in such a model, is usually in the energy, it's very close, these are very small fermionic-like structures, so they are usually only a few lattice parameters in diameter, unless you tune the parameters to a certain direction, to some critical point towards the transition where this helix unwinds completely, which can be done, but you need good people in the intrinsic world material which does. The other thing is there's no chiral term in this, so you can turn right and left. And here is sort of the so-called toroidal moment depicted for the local helicity, and it changes sign when you go right and left for the solution of such a fermion in two dimensions, which would also come out from such a big theory dimension. So this means you can really use frustrated antiferromagnets, for instance, which are close to frustration, but still where they start to become chemical, and try to introduce a fermion-like configurations, and eventually in a certain parameter range you may be lucky and they are stable. We have naturally to tune a lot of parameters, not only these exchange parameters, which are competing here, but also anisotropies. And the functionals or the theory for these things is just only developing in the last years. But there's a big perspective to make ultra small fermions, really very small, and they are, in this sense, they're not really continuum objects, and topological stability is a very relative concept, even if you have a clip-based spin system. But this is a really perspective for the future, at least for theoreticians, there's some work to do. So, this is the first set of conclusions. We can stabilize multidimensional solitons by a classical fermion-like mechanism. As described by this having a first and second neighbor in interactions in this frustrated magnets, the generic situation in that case is that we have to introduce additional next steps. These higher order gradient terms always involve such an additional length space, also additional energy space, which come with that. There is no systematic expansion in gradient terms, and this is a very crucial point. In principle, all these theories which you then would like to use in a field theory, where you can do it more easily calculations than on the gradient scale for the theoreticians, can be written in very many ways, and there can be in principle infinite sequence of higher order gradient terms become relevant in such a model. And unlike in these Kantor theories, where one knows, okay, one has to go up to the second or at most fourth gradient term sometimes, how to concrete such an expansion is not clear. This is a problem with gradient expansions of theories generally, if you have such complicated interactions. So essentially you need to know a more specific model. Magnetism, it may not be a big problem because you can really have a real material and calculate exchange indicators, say, from microscopic considerations or from data from experiments, and then start to calculate. So. But technically, all this analysis will be extremely difficult. One of the things is that already the Euler equation for such a field theory as partial differential equations are extremely difficult to have. Now, what we have been doing so far was Kanchinsky models, so we go back now from, so to say, this outlook into a more wide realm of magnetism, where you have frustrated magnetism and try to have such localized states there. With Kanchinsky models and the Geiger magnets, where we have a better handle on why our astronomers are there and where to look for materials. A closer look into this assess, and this is a paper for Kanchinsky, the first one in a series of papers on modulated magnetic states, also anti-magnetic states in 1964. That you can expand the modulated state around a certain base modulation vector in key space, and you can do this in a lambda type of fashion. So you have a square term which is homogeneous. This is just a lambda alpha parameter which when the temperature goes below T naught says there is a spontaneous order parameter which is denoted here as a phi. And you have real terms. This is a Kanchinsky Lipschitz invariant, which are linear. This is not a delta function, but it's classic notation. This is linear with respect to your base point where you start. This would be a Lipschitz invariant, and then there are second order Cartan terms. You should treat this as a sort of matrix equation in this space for possible nodes. And one knows then that one can use apparatus of Cook theory, that when you look for the irreducible representation around this base modulation, the magnetic node for your magnetic thing, of the small or little group surrounding this with the same symmetries in key space. Now, so far we had gamma points, so modes were just ferromagnetic or magnetization vector, or we had an antiferromagnet which has just a blue sub-metal structure within the unit cell. So here the keynote would be zero, and there are starting about little groups. And there's also no degree of freedom. You have to stay at the gamma point with your basic magnetic mode. This means if you want to recognize something as a phase, which is magnetically stable, you have to look, you cannot distort this. But Kanchinsky's idea was, in general, you may have a mixture of an order parameter where you add a few modes which are off from this key mode. So you add additional modulated Fourier components of the order parameter, and then you look where the free energy minimum is. That's why you wrote the free energy in this mode. So, and then he says the following, and this was later then, if you have the Lipschitz invariance, this term is there, then there's no normal phase transition possible, and you get the modulated order. This is exactly naturally what happens also in this kind of ferromagnets, that you do not order at the gamma point in the ferromagnetic state, but slightly twisted. This is given by the coefficients of delta. So, around a certain point in this space, when you look whether you can order, you have a number of new degrees of freedom for this order which you want to recognize in as your, let's say, antiferromagnetic order with a certain propagation vector, which you recognize in diffraction. The question is whether there are nearby Fourier modes in the mixture of the real state which develops, which would be the textual mass. Now there's a so-called weak Lipschitz criterion which says that a few Lipschitz invariants are still allowed. This means the degrees of freedom, you see the degrees of freedom here should be large, the number of degrees of freedom should be larger than the number of Lipschitz invariants in my free energy. This means if you have such an exchange leading magnet, this new effect of propagation vector detection along the line of symmetry. This is the case like this Bosrum or this Magnanis-Golf 2. You have just the propagation vector which is along the line of symmetry. You can shorten or lengthen it. This means the helix expand or contract a bit. But still, the helix magnetic order you still recognize this means. In that case, also you are off somewhere in the space with your ordering modes, which still have a completely normal magnetic phase transition. It is different when you have a cubic Halley magnet, which can be also a cubic antiferromagnet. Magnet. In that case, you are at the gamma point, as in the orders we have described so far. And you have no degree of freedom for your basic magnetic mode. You have just to stay at the gamma point because you break symmetry when you go away from it. But you have in that case three Lipschitz invariants. This is the Zalcinski-Novian interaction in that case. And this means such a thing cannot have a normal continuous phase transition from the paramagnetic state to the electromagnetic states, and it behaves strangely. And this is a gap in which you can avoid having just a normal boring lambda type transition from the paramagnetic to the magnetic in the order state, and where skolmions and Halley magnetism and so on of an unconventional nature arises. Now there's no shortage of such systems. With Lipschitz invariants, and sometimes you couple different ordering modes, so in the basic lambda theory of structural phase transition, something arises. This is of no concern in magnetism. But you can have it also in ferroelectrics with the non-central symmetric parent, and you can have it in multiferroids where this is a dielectric polarization and a magnetization magnetic order parameter, or in hybrid liquid crystals, or in John Simon's theories in Gampage theories. This means in principle such effects arises in many systems, but so far they have best described in the hybrid liquid crystals, the polystyrenics, and in this field. In terms of multidimensional states. Multidimensional states exist certainly here also of that time driven by such terms, but they have not been really well described yet. And in ferroelectrics, they should exist, but have not been seen to my knowledge yet. Here, in structural phase transitions, often the anisotropies, which choose a certain direction of the order parameter, if it has a decrease of freedom, are very large, so that it is difficult to make multidimensional solitary states. Now, in hybrid magnets, as I said, we have now seen that there are two possibilities to have modulated states. This here was the exchange state model I described just now, and there are many of them. They are usually centrosymmetric systems, and you can have, for instance, here right-handed and left-handed helix as a ground state. The other class are these systems described by Zalcinski models, where spirals arise, and the most well-known by now are the ferromagnetic Halley magnets, and silicon, iron, germanium, this is all family. But there are many others, and some of them are antiferromagnets, for instance, this here is a geometrically frustrated antiferromagnet. This is a simple antiferromagnet, and there are also counterparts which are simply polymer. This is a helical system which we described already yesterday. But if you look at the copper by cobalt, it is just a nanar simple antiferromagnet, and in principle there would be strongions antiferromagnet in the cobalt system. But the list is very long, and the important thing is that this left side essentially is ruled by standard lambda theory of phase transitions, where you have just continuous phase transitions, where the order parameter amplitude just grows from the paramagnetic state continuously by having such a mode at a certain key point, which may be somehow temperature dependent, but you start just continuously. Here, transitions function completely different because you have the solitoid nature of any modulation. It behaves simply differently than a simple lambda theory. And this is the reason why in the theory of continuous phase transition, one generally says if there are Lipschitz invariants, then there shouldn't be a continuous phase transition. It's not completely true, as I illustrated with this leak, which is calculated, we have to look a bit more closely. But if you have enough Lifshitz invariants, then you have immodulated states. So, and this was a basic paper from which this insight that there are multidimensional modulated states arises. And in the first equation in which Bucher and Lapolsky wrote, they hit everything which is important in this W prime. This is the Lifshitz invariant. So they have not written the basic term which is important, but the boring micromagnetic or continuous magnetic terms. Important is that they say they are stable vortices in magnetically ordered crystal, and they immediately refer to Aprikosov lattices as a mixed state. So the theory is very similar, that we have vortices which are somehow assembled to some surfaces, some structures which are much more complicated than a normal magnetic state. Now I will describe quickly what one can know near the phase in such a Zalushinsky model near the phase transition, because this is an important point. There you can recognize in a small gap whether this magnetic phase transition is anomalous, and this may for certain materials class give you a hint that such effects are there, even if the ground state is evolving maybe according to our magnetic state. So we did a theory where we added a bit of longitudinal softness to the usual Gatian term encoded by such an eta, and we had just the Lifshitz invariant, which is here written somewhere where, for an isotropic or cubic system, and otherwise a Landau expansion of the other parameter, which is just M, a ferromagnetic or in the second polarization of the material, which is what are happening in three dimensions. So this is an isotropic cubic magnetic. If you have something like this, then you can make on the paramagnetic background strange states which are confined in a circular fashion in two dimensions, where the magnetization is largest at the center. This is the plot here over the radius, where it starts with a large magnetization, which goes down to zero at some finite radius. Simultaneously, the tilt angle of this, by under the influence of the Zalushinsky Moria interaction, rotates. Almost linearly, there's a small slight curvature here. And if you now plot the skirmion radius versus the critical temperature, which is positive because the Zalushinsky energy wins against the bare ferromagnetic Curie temperature and additional energy, that's when you start to order at finite temperature, the radius starts at infinity and comes down if you lower the temperature. So essentially, in a macroscopic specimen, we can think about that the nucleation of one skirmion is the first indication of the phase transition. And it starts with infinite radius and goes in, and then comes the next and the next. This is what one calls a nucleation transition. It's not a normal transition. It's continuous, right, because the contribution of the first skirmion in a macroscopic sample is actually infinitely small. So it starts continuously to evolve in the order. But it's still not a normal continuous phase transition because you have this localized structure which arises in this state. And here you see the magnetic moment at the center. This is this here, there's a temperature which comes up by such a critical curve. This is just an infinite theory. And we showed in this paper that eventually, if you do allow for some extra softness or some other parameter, that between the paramagnetic phase and the Helix phase, which is the ground state of this model, there's a possibility we have skirmions. I skip this. So now where to look? This interests the materials people. Where should one look? Essentially, all gyrotropic crystal classes do this. So you have to exclude what is here, this high symmetry system. Crystal classes don't have Lifshitz invariants for simple magnetic order parameters. This means, for instance, heat bend structure and a lot of things which you may like don't do it. But all others do it. and there are special things. Here, these base groups are our crystal classes in this blue circle or blue, but these ones, excluding the red ones, have Gibbs invariants in all three Cartesian special directions. This means you have the possibility to make modulations in all special directions. For ferromagnets, this is a nuisance, because as we have seen, this program of Couple phase is stabilized as fermion lattice against hexagonal one is stabilized in applied field, but it doesn't win against the conical helix. If you apply a field in this type of magnets, especially the cubic ones, the helix rotates with this propagation direction in the field direction and then forms a conical helix which points towards the field direction. In the isotropic chiral magnet, this is everywhere in the ground state in the magnetic phase that it comes up by field. So anti-ferromagnets and maybe other considerations, but generically in none of these systems we have ECK. These special crystal classes, the polar ones and B2B, have for symmetry reasons Lipschitz invariants only in the master way. And therefore in the magnetic phase diagram of the chiral ferromagnet we will have a T equals zero this program of Couple phase. And the original idea was that one should look first here to find the chiral such a phase field-driven fermion lattice, because it is diffraction actually is very simple to see, at least for a theoretician. If one imagines that one looks for something like this, is much easier to have an ordered state. There is now, from the polar classes, there are these Lachmanar spinels from the Schmalke and Leudens group, which is really an example for such a system. So there are systems which do it. Okay, so this is for simple magnetically ordered systems, and here I briefly summarize what sort of textures we have described so far. So this is a conical helix, which I just described for a ferromagnet. This is a helicoid. This is a half-stromion lattice, which can exist near the paramagnetic state. There are half-stromions with a defect in the center assembly to reach a higher density of stromions. And these are plus and pi stromion, plus minus pi stromion lattices. The difference is that the one has a q plus, so a topological index in the cell, plus one, and this is minus one. Magnetization of all the parameters in the center is up or down. So this is naturally more for ferromagnets that will influence all these things and have been a very close competition between these phases. I want to make another point about this instability of modulated states and this hand-cross-state condition. If you have a continuous transition, this is nucleation type of thing, then you see that the Fourier transform modes of your texture, which you see, if you look for higher order contributions, the ratio to the base modulation goes towards transition to a constant. This means you have always a full harmonic content, whereas in the instability type, it is just one mode, the one in Landau theory which holds the phase transition, which goes to zero at the transition. Therefore, in principle, in an ideal situation, one expects that one recognizes that there are these localized states if something like this here happens. But this doesn't happen usually. And the reason is very simple. I show this here in the transformation under field for a ferromagnetic sturmio lattice. So this is some sturmio lattice which here is very stable at low feet. The magnetization here in the center is downward. I think this block is here wrong. It's downward and they are really close by each other. If you now apply a feet, the score of the sturmio shrinks. And finally, at a certain point, so there is a lattice parameter of the sturmio lattice will increase. At a certain point, finally, the lattice will lose its stability. But at this point, the sturmions, because they are topologically stable and they are basically whole, will still be there. So they are still there, but they are really not interacting anymore. if you do this at private temperatures in the green material, it is clear that you have some cooling fluctuations and so on. So these gluons will be still there. And if you would then decrease the field and come back, we will eventually see even those spaces. So this is a completely weird situation that formerly in our thinking as theorists, this is a continuous phase transition where you just nucleate something and then evaporate it or condense it. When you create re-established the lattice, but at such a transition you see your statistics in a real experiment. So you should be aware of the fact that the perfect order which is here in the ideal theory as an hexagonal lattice up to this point will eventually be destroyed much earlier because you cannot have such a very established lattice of two-dimensional objects being assembled. And then maybe you say this is the experiment. So the green phase transition which you will look and observe in such a system will be completely different than this nice simple theoretical ideas. So, first set of conclusions. Chiral magnets are still probably lost to investigate because they are condensed phases of 1D and 2D nature. Modulated, which are based on localized states, among them is sternions. The phase-time diagram of such systems will have a close competition between various mesophases. And this I should explain a bit further for antiferromagnets. In the meantime, in the literature, we know that, for instance, exchange anisotropy of a square type stabilizes fermion lattices even in zero field for the ferromagnetic model. But this directly applies also to antiferromagnets. So there may be certain antiferromagnets which have a fermion lattices at ground state or at least in a certain temperature interval because you have no staggered field. You cannot induce fermions like we have here in the ferromagnets. But it could be there. But it always will complete this antiferromagnetic valence state. And in diffraction, you will then see, say, in a pentagonal system, two different domains, so different propagation directions for these helix domains. The fermion lattice in diffraction will also contribute for black spots, say, for the basic Fourier modes we should observe. That means you cannot easily distinguish this, and you must know much more. This is your system to claim from science diffraction experiment there are really fermions in there. You will have great difficulties. It is clear that these mesophases have different properties. Because assembly of fermions may, for instance, not really order well in the sense of a lattice. So you have only some quasi long-range order, but this quasi long-range order will be different. In the quasi long-range order of the helix, which is like a polysteric liquid crystal, and also not long-range order, which you can read already in the Landau Lipschitz book on statistical physics, which is already described. This is a fluctuation effect. So, if you want to detect fermions in antiferromagnets in such a concept, then you will have to do a lot of work if you want to go for that business. So, this, I think, I stop here. With how much time do I still have?
5 minutes.
Okay. So, now how it was found is more or less one part of the story here. There were these groups where they are looking at manganese silicon and this carbon magnets for a long time. So, Kleiderer's group, this is Mirac, Mühlbauer did this for completely other reasons. They were principally interested in ferromagnetic quantum critical point, which is reached in manganese silicon, where the ferromagnetic order disappears under pressure somewhere, and they saw their strange state. And for them, this chiral magnetism was more nuisance, some additional complication. But this has evolved into a medium-sized factory where they produce a lot of precise. And it was known much earlier, mainly from Bloch in research, but in the fact that close to the phase transition, which is here at 30 Kelvin, there's a small temperature interval, there's in three, there's a strange phase where the modulation direction is perpendicular to the applied field. Earlier, there had been lots of work showing that this is a complicated region with various pockets of strange phases for macroscopic thermodynamic measurements. And simultaneously with the experiments described in this paper, Katharine Pappas found that here this transition in zero field is also strange. It means that in a temperature interval of about 1 Kelvin, there is a fully chiral magnetic order which has no long-range order established above this. This was done with spin polarized neutrons and some fancy spin echo methods, where they actually claimed that one can probably not explain this as normal fluctuations like in a paramagnet, ferromagnet, but the transition there is strange. There's a group in St. Petersburg around Maliev and Kikoyev who have also done a huge amount of work on this, which shows that this A phase really exists in many of these chiral cubic magnets. And the Munich group essentially claims everything is now understood in terms of so-called Krasovsky theory, which says you have interacting helices and the fluctuation of these things, because these helices can propagate in any direction of the first order phase transition here, and explains also the arising of a multi-Q structure, triple Q as basic Fourier modes, which looks topologically like fermion lattice. So this is in bulk systems the status of such things, of the experiments, and then came, in my point of view, the decisive step that in such systems, iron germanium, iron copper, silicon, Dubois groups saw fermion lattices by looking at thin films with Lorentz microscopy. And they showed also that this fermion lattices, you may have seen some such pictures, can be evaporated and synthesis fermions are there. And in the next step, Wiesenthaler's group from Hamburg showed in ultra-thin films that similar structures on a very small scale also exist. Now, as I have described to you, that the magnetic phase transition in such systems which obey the Alshinsky model may be a bit complicated, I want to make an important point. The fermion lives happily in a curved space in two dimensions. But even the fermion is frustrated still. Even if you have a fermion lattice where you think you have done tremendously well of using all energy terms well, is not really living happily. It would have liked to use also this twisting term in the third direction, but this is not possible. Because you can going out from magnetization up, you can rotate only in two directions like this and perform this double twist structure which I have described very often. It means that the fermion lattice is also a defected structure in the sense that it is not completely optimal. And there's a huge tendency that you build defected structures. This is known for a very long time and was described in a long series of works since the 1970s, simultaneously when these concepts of topological defects were developed. And it is called, if we have a curved space and want to make a flat thing out of it, it is described as the orange peel carpet. You take the orange, peel it, and stand it down onto the floor, and you see that you cannot avoid having something. And in the chiral magnets, this is still the main thing. We know now that in these magnetic films, Topula has investigated the fermions which are there are twisted also in the third direction. And a lot of energy comes, or stabilizing them, comes from this third order dimension twist against the conical helix, which is also possible. The other thing is, near cubic temperature or near magnetic ordering temperature, the magnetic order parameter itself is not split anymore, and the helix transforms according to an effect which is similarly described by Kulaevsky in his work for linear action magnets. It's described by an object which has something like a symbol, it goes to zero, and is operating simultaneously. This means near the ordering transition temperature, the directional component of the order parameter and the lengths are coupled and cannot be decoupled by any way. So this is built into this theory, and that's the reason why close to the ordering temperature, we will have not a simple multi-q structure. This is from conceptually completely impossible that something like this occurs. It must be a defected structure. And therefore, at the moment, the community, which is depicted here, is struggling over this issue. And I think because theory is a deep insight into the basic functioning of these things, in the end, we will come up with a much more complicated picture than a simple triple Q structure for these five magnets. And it has importance for you as a anti-ferromagnetics community in the future. If you are looking for materials, be aware that in very small temperature intervals, around magnetic order between temperatures, there may be very anomalous behavior. And I can make a suggestion that you can start to look for material classes, but it was a question material class, which is extremely interesting, is materials which have better magnetic structure. There are qubit structures which order in completely irrational fashion, and the reason is there are functions in models, in magnets. They are also geometrically constrained, but this is not all. They have also solutions in area for any of their operating modes. So, with this, I stop. That's my attention. In principle, we can solve these equations only numerically, and these solutions exist, and we know how they look. And they have higher order, the ideal solutions have higher order Fourier modes, but the real structure are not dimension order, which are observed in experiment. This is the same argument why, apropos of that, this is under dimension order. This is two dimensional crystallization and it's simply not possible. And what has been observed is, in reality, a liquid of exotic structure of cubes, or maybe something more complicated. But this function that I showed here for the theorists, this looks completely innocent and simple, but it is not. We know if you add now anisotropies and some extra small terms, we know very little about it. Detailed functioning of this means and the thermodynamic of this model, if we treat it as a statistical free theory, is not going out. The reason is essentially that it is a free theory with a frozen data and an abelian expectation background. And the free theoreticians know that then you have these localized structures and then everything is very good. So it looks very simple, but we have only numerics at the moment to generate this absolute.
What happens at the domain wall between two helical structures?
That's a good question. There are domain walls where you just bend the propagation direction and they can be coherent without defects, but other domain walls like twisted ones, they are incoherent and there must be defects. And in that case, you will have structures which resemble the dislocation structures in polyspheric liquid crystals. This has been worked out also with Clément and Friedel, and these names were also sometimes in my slides somewhere in the photos. There you can do something about this. But in that case, you can have either real defects with hedgehogs or partial hedgehogs, or you can have smooth defects where you only have defects for the face. This is like a symmetric liquid crystal. So one-dimensional crystal and then dislocations inside. And by this you can bend the direction of the helium.
But it's possible to get a line of chiral structures, the chiral entities.
Yeah. I'm not aware of much numerical recently, and for magnetism it has not been yet started because with three-dimensional simulations or calculations are extremely demanding. Just for such things. So, but there's possibility, and this one is extremely complicated, actually, like dislocations inside as well.
Well, thank you again.